from New York Times bestselling author Jensen Franklin, Why We Fast.
Look with me in Isaiah chapter 58. Isaiah chapter 58. Isaiah chapter 58. Begin reading with verse 6. And you know, for the sake of time, I'm not going to read the scripture. I'll preach it. I'll preach every verse for a few moments in just a moment. But you can turn there and have your Bible open. And I encourage you to take some notes today if you want to, because this is always a different, a little bit of different service. It's more about inspiring and informing you about fasting. And so I want to start by telling you that today I want to preach on when you should fast. When you should fast. You see, fasting, or the word fast, is found in the Bible 75 times. Fasting is tying a ribbon around your finger to remember God. Fasting is making space for God in your busy life. When you fast, you are in a small way walking with those who suffer from hunger. Realize that there are 40,000 people, mostly almost all children, who will die of starvation before the day is over. Every 24 hours that goes by, 40,000 children die of starvation in the world. And when you fast, you enter in a small way into the world that 40,000 people will perish from, because they don't have anything to eat. Fasting, I believe, is really stepping into the heart of God that grieves for hurting, broken humanity that He loves and He created. Fasting embraces emptiness. It is a form of withdrawing from normal life and the regular world that we live in. Every now and then, we need to interrupt our lives and make space for God. It's emptying out ourselves, not just to food, but I encourage you to limit entertainment, limit media, limit internet usage, limit movies, limit any form of entertainment, because listen, these things contaminate a fast. When you sit in front of a TV hour after hour after hour and watch TV or the internet or go to movies and just carry on normal life, it contaminates your fast. Fasting is about pulling yourself away from the normality of life and saying, God, I'm making space for you. So as much as you can, I'm not saying you have to completely not watch TV and all that. I'm not saying that, but I am saying limit that in your life and spend more time in spiritual things such as the Word of God and feeding your spirit. It's creating an empty space for God to feel when you are fasting. You see, I believe that fasting is body talk. Fasting is body language to God. When we fast, we are expressing our heart hunger for Jesus. So fasting is body language and body talk to God that expresses how serious we are about wanting Him in our life. Now, it's so important to understand that not everyone who fasts with the right motive. And the Bible warns about fasting with the wrong motive. For example, the Bible says in 1 Kings 21 and 9 that there was a woman by the name of Jezebel who proclaimed a fast. You know what she fasted for? She proclaimed a fast that Naboth would die and she would get his land to give to her husband. Now, isn't that a crazy thing to fast for? She fasted and had him killed after she fasted so her husband could obtain his piece of property. In other words, she was fasting for selfish gain. When you fast for selfish gain, when you fast for the manipulation of other people, when you fast and say, I'm doing this so God will do this, you don't give God ultimatums on a fast. Fasting isn't about you getting God to do what you want Him to do. It's about getting God to do what He wants to do in every circumstance in your life. And you have to have the right motive. Secondly, in Luke chapter 18, Jesus told the story of the tax tax collector who came and the Pharisee who came, and they both wanted eternal life. And the scripture said that the Pharisee said to Jesus, "I fast twice a week and I give a tenth of all my income." And the poor sinner tax collector said, "Lord, I am a sinner. Be merciful upon me." And the scripture said that the man who came in humility left forgiven, but he said the Pharisee needs to be rebuked. In other words, the man was fasting, but he was fasting without humility. The Bible said, if you don't humble yourself, God will humble you. But if you humble yourself, God will exalt you. Fasting is humbling yourself so God can promote and exalt you. And he will do it every time when you do it with the right motive. The tax collector got the blessing, and the Pharisee was rejected by Jesus. In Acts chapter 23, there's the story of 40 Jews who swore an oath that they would not eat food until they assassinated the Apostle Paul. These religious people were doing such a religious thing. They were fasting, and they entered into an oath, and they said, "We won't eat a bite until that Apostle Paul, who's preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ, dies." Anytime you're fasting that somebody would die, or that you're hoping harm will come to somebody, your motive is not right. And God, you might as well go on and eat, because you're just a fool for doing that. When I fast, it changes everything. It's like the air around me changes. When you fast, it is a time when God will draw near to you. Fasting is powerful. I want to ask you something. Do you need God's protection on your children? Do you need the salvation of your family? Do you need wisdom and favor and healing? Do you need freedom from demonic oppression? Do you need help with an overwhelming problem? Have you failed in the past and you don't want to fail in the future? You want to succeed? Are you dealing with unhealthy habits that are destroying your life and your health? Are you facing circumstances that feel too big for you? Then it's time for you to fast. Fasting is not just about keeping ourselves from food. It's about gaining rewards. You see, the Bible promises rewards to people who fast. The reward is the solution that you seek. The reward is the provision that you need. The reward is the healing and the deliverance that you so desire. And the Bible says that every time people fasted in the Bible, God rewarded their fast with what they were scripturally asking for. If the motive is right, if the heart is right, and you're fasting for biblical purposes, God rewards fasting every time. You see, in Ezra, the Bible said that they fasted for the protection of their children and for their possessions and for divine direction. And the scripture said that God gave them what they fasted for. Now, I want you to listen to me. When you focus on the reward of fasting, it helps you not focus on the hunger of fasting. So get a reward. Figure out why you're fasting. Fast for a specific desire and write it down and list the things that you're fasting about. And it'll help you focus on that instead of how hungry you are. If you're fasting, expect the reward for your fasting. Secret seeking brings open reward. Now, Isaiah 58 begins to list the rewards that come in the life of the faster. Verse 6 of Isaiah 58 says, number one, that when you fast, he says, this is the fast that I have chosen. And he says, it will loose the bands of wickedness. Bands are things that hold you back. Bands are things that stop you from advancing. Have you ever felt like something was holding you back? Like you just couldn't go any further. You'd get so far in the dream and in the success and in the blessing, and it's like you can't break further into what you know God has for you. Well, when you fast, it breaks you free from everything that's holding you back, and it allows you to advance in what God has for your life. And then he said, not only will it break the bands of wickedness, it will release you from what's holding you, but he says in the next part of that verse, it will undo the heavy burdens. So many people are heavily burdened. So many people are down and discouraged. But he said, when you fast, it will undo. And the word undo means to tear off. And the literal Hebrew meaning is to violently pull them off. God says, when you fast, I will violently pull the heavy burdens off of you. The things that have just been pressing you down and depressing you and making you feel hopeless and helpless, as you fast, you will shake them loose forever in Jesus' name. And then he said, this is the fast that will cause the oppressed. The next thing he says, the oppressed will go free. The oppressed means the discouraged. It means the bruised and the wounded. So many walking wounded all around us. And he said, the word picture of the word oppression is one of a vase that is cracking up. In other words, God is saying, I'm going to set people free and lift people and heal people who are cracking up, people who are oppressed of the devil, people who are falling apart. Their marriage is cracking up. Their life is cracking up. He says, I'm going to put you back together. And the first day you start fasting, he starts mending you. He starts the process of healing, of putting your life back together. And he is able to do it because he said, this is one of the rewards of fasting. And then the next thing he says, it will break every yoke. A yoke is a bondage. A yoke is a bad habit. A yoke is something that is destroying you physically. He said, I can break the bad habits if you'll come to me and fast about it. You got bad habits that are keeping you in bondage, hindering your health, shortening your life, destroying your Christian witness. You can have a breakthrough in those areas through fasting. You don't have to be addicted to alcohol. You don't have to be addicted to nicotine. You don't have to be addicted to pornography. You don't have to live that life of being under a yoke and in bad habits the rest of your life. If you will fast about it, God says, I will break that yoke off of your neck. Somebody give God praise. It's happening even as I'm speaking. Come on and praise him for freedom. Come on and praise him, because there's no yoke that Satan has put on you or your family that's going to be on it 21 days from now. In Jesus' name. I'm so tired of bound up Christians, bound up just as much as the world, just as addicted as the world. It's time to be free. It's time to get free. He said, the next reward of your life, if you fast, will be your light. Your light. Or the next thing he said, you will give bread to the hungry. You know, have you ever sat and watched, and that is a reward, to get to feed the hungry. You know, have you ever sat and watched some of these TV shows and seen the starving children and said to yourself, I wish I had some money, I would do that. Well, you're going to have some money because you're not going to spend it on food. So now you can do that. And this week I'll get to fly to Haiti, and I'm going for one day and coming back the next day, but I'll be there when we give our first delivery of 540,000 meals that this ministry is providing for the starving, the poorest nation in the world, the starving children. We're going to do it every month this year. 540,000 meals. I'll be there when those huge containers about the size of this room come in. Come on. Shout with me. You are making that happen, and I thank you. We're feeding these precious children that are starving. And then the next reward, he said, is your light will break forth in the morning as the morning sun if you seek me in fasting. When you read the Bible, something's going to dawn on you. You got problems that are perplexing you. He said, my light of revelation is going to shine. You don't know what to do with your life. You don't know what college to go to. You don't know what direction to take. You don't know if you should marry that person. You don't know which way to go, what career to go after. Should you apply for the issue? He said, I'll give you revelation. My light will shine on you. I'll give you God-sent ideas. I will communicate my will and my direction for your life when you fast and when you pray. And if you're in darkness, the darkness that you've been walking in shall be broken. I just want to make this declaration. The darkness that you walked in 2009 shall be broken in the 2010 21-day fast. If you believe it, give God a shout of praise. No more darkness. No more darkness. God is going to catapult some of your businesses light years ahead because you sought God in fasting and prayer and he showed you something that you didn't see, and boom, it's just going to happen. That's how God does it. You know, my first 21-day fast that I ever went on many, many years ago, I was 19 years old and I went on a full 21-day fast only drinking liquids. I only weighed about 135 pounds back then. And so you can imagine, it was a little bit scary. I didn't know what I was doing. I hadn't been taught, you know, how to do that. Nobody had a book that I read. I just did it. And I felt like God told me to do it. I knew he told me to do it. And so for 21 days, I'm fasting. And at the end of that 21 days, I tell you the truth, the Lord spoke to me in my spirit. And he said, and I didn't understand it then, I understand it now. He said, because you have sought me in 21 days of fasting, I have advanced your ministry 10 years. In other words, what it would have taken you 10 years to do in the natural, I have caused you to advance those 10 years. Within a few months, I was asked at the age of 20 to speak at the Winterfest youth conference of my denomination that had thousands of people. I was just a young preacher, had only been preaching a few months. That opened up doors all over the nation. You know, I got to thinking about this 10-year thing. And suddenly I was out all over the nation. God had opened doors. And then at the young age of 28, I pulled up to the old building on Browns Bridge Road and became the pastor of Free Chapel. Now normally, you know, you'd get a pastor of 38 or 48, not 28, and never pastored before any church. And then now I'm 47, and, you know, this building is paid off. And I thought about this. If we would have been on the normal schedule, we'd have had 10 more years of interest. But we paid it off last year. The Lord said, I can advance your career 10 years. Oh, you don't hear me. You need some faith. You need to believe God for the rewards of fasting. And it's really been that way all my life. And I don't deserve it. It's just when you seek God, he blesses you. You see, the next thing he said is your health will spring forth speedily when you fast. He didn't say you'll die. He said you'll live. People aren't dying of overeating. They're not dying of fasting. They're dying of overeating. And so when you fast, fasting is an internal shower for your body. Fasting is the fastest and healthiest way to lose weight. Fasting lowers your cholesterol and blood pressure. Fasting is a miracle rejuvenator. Fasting slows the aging process. Fasting eliminates smoking and drinking and bad eating habits and drug addiction. Dr. Albert Schweitzer said, every patient carries his own doctor within. Fasting is the physician within. The Bible said in Genesis 6:3, man's day shall be 120 years. When you fast, your body is cleansing and repairing and healing itself. It's emptying itself of poisonous toxins and unhealthy things that have accumulated in your body. Are you in health bankruptcy? There is a thinner, more youthful you waiting to be released through fasting. Just turn to somebody and say, there's a thinner, more healthier, youthier you waiting to be released. Every animal in the wilderness uses fasting as a method to help overcome physical illness that befalls them. It is a pure animal instinct when you have disease to fast. Now, there are people who should not fast. Pregnant women should not do the full fast, and certainly diabetics have to alter and check with their physicians, and nursing mothers and young children. And if you have physical issues, if you've got the flu or something like that, you don't need to do this fast at this time. You need to wait until you get healthy and strong, and God will honor it all the same. We got you covered. Don't worry about it. But I'm talking to the people who are healthy out there. In Oakland, California, Arthur Reed lived to be 123 years old. He said, "I don't drink, I don't smoke, and I fast one meal a day." He lived to be 123 years old. I'm not saying you'll live to be that old. I don't know that I want to live to be that old. But I'm saying that fasting is healthy when you do it right and when you do it in the timing of God. The next thing he said, everybody say, "My health will spring forth." The next thing he said is, "Righteousness will go before you, and the glory of God will be your rear guard." When you fast, he says two things. "I'll be a shield of protection that it guards you from frontal attacks, and I'll be the rear guard that stops anything from your past touching you and catching up with you and defeating you in your present." He said, "I'll do this for the faster." And then he says, "And you shall call, and the Lord shall answer. I will say, here I am." See, when you fast, it does something to your prayers that causes quick answers, fast answers, lightning speed answers to come. And he said, "Your light will rise out of obscurity, and your darkness will be as the noonday." What does that mean? It means you're going to become successful. When you fast, he says, "I'll raise you out of obscurity. I'll raise you out of hiding. I'll raise you out of defeat and failure, and you will have success." Success will shine on your life. You will no longer walk in that darkness. It's going to be broken off of your life. And then the next thing he says, the reward, he said, "And the Lord shall guide you continually." How many of you want his guidance in 2010? He said, you won't have to ask people what to do. You won't have to wonder what to do. And he didn't say, "I'll guide you some of the time." He said, "I, God, will guide you continually. If you will fast and pray, your steps this year will be ordered of the Lord." And then he said, "I'll satisfy your soul in drought. I'll make your bones fat. You'll be like a watered garden. You'll be like a spring of water whose waters fail not." What is that talking about? That's talking about our economic condition. Fasting helps us not to live from paycheck to paycheck, but from promise to promise. It does not matter what the economic conditions of the world are. When you fast, your needs are going to be supplied. No matter what the situation is, no matter what ABC, CBS, NBC, and woe is me is saying about depression and unemployment and all that junk, I'm telling you that when you fast, God says, "I will meet your needs." You'll have a watered garden, and listen to what he said, "The water won't fail. The resources that I send will not stop. They will not dry up. They will not quit. You're going to have a flow of finances as you seek me in fasting and prayer. God is going to provide for you. Quit worrying and start fasting." Give him a big shout of praise if you believe he's going to make a way. Then he says this. He says, "If you fast, I'll use you to build the old waste places, and they'll become paths to dwell in. I'll use you to turn wastelands into fruitful orchards. I'll use you to take those lives that have been desolate and broken and destroyed by drugs and alcohol and illicit sex. And you'll turn them into fruitful orchards. They're wastelands, marriages and homes and families that are wastelands. I can restore the relationship. I'll turn it into a fruitful garden. I'll cause the area that is a wasteland. I was telling the early morning service, I've got a preacher friend who started a church in a bar many years ago. He started his church in a bar. He didn't have any money, and he found out this. They had a little area where the people would dance and stuff, and it was enough room that he could have a little pulpit up where the band would play, and he could let his little congregation sit where the people danced. And they would have the club open every night of the week, 7 nights a week, but they didn't use it on Sunday morning because everybody was hungover. So he started renting it from the owner of that building for Sunday morning service. And he'd go in and set up, and he was turning that old wasteland into a fruitful orchard. And people started getting saved, and people started getting saved, and the bar started having problems. They went bankrupt. The bar went bankrupt, and the preacher bought the building. You know, when we took this piece of property, it was just 150 acres of wasteland. But now we got a fruitful orchard on it. That's what God can do with your marriage. That's what God can do with your family. That's what God can do with anybody in your family that is a wasteland right now. God says, don't give up on them. Fast for them. Fast for them. Fast for them. Fast for them. Now, I want to quickly give you 5 ways to supercharge your fast. 5 ways to supercharge your fast. Are you getting anything out of this? Yeah. Nehemiah 9 verses 1 through 3 gives 5 ways to supercharge your fast. He says in that first verse, now the 24th day of the month, the children of Israel were assembled with fasting. Everybody say assembled. The first way you supercharge your fast is you gather together with other believers. You assemble in special times of prayer. That's why we're having prayer meetings during this fast every Monday, every Tuesday night at 6 o'clock for 1 hour. They will be powerful. Be here. Rearrange your life. Make space for God. But during the fast, it is critical. Don't miss any of these services. I tell you what's going to happen. Every weekend, every service will get higher and higher. The anointing will get greater and greater. And I believe that we will see the power of God manifest in this place. But it requires assembling. The way you supercharge your fast, get in a small group, get in prayer meeting, get around other people who are fasting, because they will encourage you when you have a Big Mac attack. They will keep you going, saying, no, 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 don't do that. We need a buddy system almost. You know, if you get weak, just call somebody up and say, I'm seeing visions of French fries and I need healing. Pray for me. And you laugh, but you won't be laughing around 6 o'clock tonight. I know. Assemble. Turn to somebody and say, we need to gather together. That's why we're going to have a revival during this fast. The Perry Stone's going to come and preach, and we're figuring out the rest who we're going to get to preach. We may have Brother Tenney come in. Whoever we can get, we're going to bring in people to preach, and we're going to have 3 nights. When is that? It's next Sunday, Monday, and Tuesday, and right into Wednesday, a revival right in the middle of the fast. Why? Because it supercharges your fast to assemble together. Stay plugged in with other believers. Secondly, the Bible says that they separated themselves. If they'll put that up, they separated themselves from the strangers. Now get it. They've assembled and they've called a fast. The next thing they do is they separate themselves from strangers. What is that about? Strangers meant strangers, that there represents non-believing influences. You know, you have to, a time to fast is a time to separate yourself. That's why I kind of hit it right off about not just fasting food, but fast with your time. Fast away from that computer and those emails and talking back and forth to your friends and fast from that music that you normally listen. Fast and from hours and hours of TV, fast from going to movies and entertainment. This is not a time to be happy and clappy. It's a time to separate yourself, to go in a mode of this is God's time in my life, and I'll spend it in the Word, and I'm coming after you, and I'm serious about this, God. I'm serious about this, and I'm going to seek you with all of my heart. And so you separate yourself. You deliberately withhold yourself from certain things that you enjoy doing during the fast. You see, your spirit is especially open during a fast, and that means it's open to godly things and ungodly things. And if you allow ungodly things in while you're fasting, it can contaminate your fast. So be very careful what you listen to and you look at. You'll be very sensitive. Listen to the Spirit. And then the next thing that they did to supercharge their fast was they confessed their sins. Notice that. They stood and confessed their sins and the iniquities of their fathers. As you're fasting, just repent. As you're fasting, God will begin to bring up things in your life, compromises, things you've said, attitudes, actions, people that you've treated wrong. As you fast, confess those sins. God, I repent. God, he said in 1 John 9:1-9, if you confess your sins, he's faithful and just to forgive your sins and to cleanse you from all iniquity. So let that happen in your life. And then the next thing he did to supercharge the fast was they spent extra time in God's Word. Notice what it says. They stood in the place and they read from the book of the law 1/4 of the day. They just stood, and as they were fasting, they were gathered together, they were separated, they had confessed their sins, and then they started getting into this book. When you fast, read this book. Read the Bible. You need to go on when we've got you some Bible charts that you can have and stick in your Bible. You need to read this book through for yourself this year. And if you start on day one today, and read just a few chapters of this book every day, like we've got it charted out for you in the Bible chart that we'll give you as you leave, you can read the whole Bible this year starting today. And every person under the sound of my voice, if you want to supercharge your fast, read this book. Read this book. Even if you don't understand it, read it. Even if you don't know what it's talking about, read it, because something's happening when you're reading this book. It's supercharging your prayers and your spirit and your fast. And then the next thing they did was they said their confessions, the scripture said. Now, this is different from confessing of sins. It's the confessing of the Word of God. In other words, you confess the promises. While you're fasting, speak the Word of God over your family. Speak the Word of God over your health. By His stripes I am healed. My family shall serve the Lord. Me and my house shall be saved. Speak the Word of God over your finances. My God shall supply. There's something about doing that that supercharges your fast. And then lastly, notice what it says, and they worshiped. Do you see that? They worship the Lord their God. So worship is critical during a fast. Worship supercharges your fast. Get CD worships and get CDs of preaching and of tapes and of messages and feed your spirit on the Word of God. Don't just go some after God. Give Him 21 days of feeding on the Word of God and worshiping Him. And when you come in here, don't you wait on anybody to sing your favorite song. You need to be passionate about worship while you're fasting. It supercharges your fast. Can you say amen, somebody? Amen. Can I conclude with this? Am I giving you too much? When should you fast? I want to give you this in closing. When should you fast? Number one, you should fast when you're facing a mammoth task. When it's something too big for you to handle by yourself. Nehemiah fasted before he rebuilt the walls because he knew it was such a mammoth task, a huge responsibility. I can't do it. Then he fasted and God gave him supernatural ability to do it in 52 days. So I say to you today that when you're moving across the country, that's a mammoth task. You should fast. When you're starting a new business, when you're starting a new ministry or a new career, you should fast. When you're adopting a child, you should fast about it. A mammoth undertaking, you should fast about it. Secondly, you should fast when you face physical danger. The Bible said that Esther fasted and the people fasted for 3 days when they were about to be wiped off of the face of the earth. Esther called a fast, or Mordecai called a fast for 3 days. Fast in the face of danger. The Bible said in Ezra 8 and 21 that they fasted for a safe journey. So when should you fast? When you're facing surgery, when you're facing some situation that's fearful and physically dangerous, you should fast about it. Or when you are going on a trip somewhere that is dangerous, you should fast about it. Or when you have a son or a daughter in the military in harm's way in Iraq or Afghanistan, you should fast for them. God will honor it if you will fast in the time of physical danger. He will rescue you. And then the third thing, when the enemy attacks us, 2 Chronicles 20, Jehoshaphat was surrounded by his enemies. Is anybody under an attack by the enemy, by Satan? You sense he's just coming at me everywhere I turn. Every angle I turn, it just seems like I'm under attack. That's the time to fast. Jehoshaphat said like this, "Lord, we know not what to do." When you don't know what to do, fast. And then the fourth time you should fast is when you're appalled at society, when you're repulsed at the condition of the culture that you're living in. And when I see our government trying to take my tax dollars and your tax dollars and fund abortions, it causes me to grieve in my spirit. One of the things Ezra 9 said, do fast for the little ones. And the Lord spoke to me this week and he said, that could include the unborn. Fast for the unborn. Fast for the babies that are being aborted by the millions. And now our government is trying with all that they have to use your tax dollars and my tax dollars to fund those abortions. God, forgive us if we're quiet about this. God, forgive us if we don't fast and pray for the little ones, for the little ones and for our nation. Jonah changed God's mind when he fasted. God was going to put judgment on Nineveh. And the Bible said in Jonah 3, that he fasted, and the scripture said that God changed his mind. Did you know you can change God's mind about judging somebody? If there's somebody in your family that's violated God's word and you sense judgment is upon their life, you can fast and God will change his mind. And then a crucial time to fast is for the church at the beginning of the year. How many of you want this church to grow and prosper? Let me see your hand. We have a choice. We can grow and prosper, or we can stagnate and we can decline. But I just believe that if we fast and pray, God will continue to make us a fruitful orchard. And then when you encounter demonic oppression, Mark chapter 9 and verse 29 said, this kind can come forth by nothing but prayer and fasting. Many, many, many people have been fighting demonic powers, and you're fighting. It's like you're going to battle with a water gun, or you're going to a gunfight with a knife. And what you have to do when you're fighting a big enemy, when you're fighting a real demon, and demons are real, and demonic oppression is real, and demonic attacks against you and your life are real. And the Bible said the thing you do when the enemy brings a gun to the battle is you don't bring a knife, but you pull out your gun, and your gun is a mighty weapon. It's the weapon of fasting, and it caused Satan himself. When Jesus fasted, Satan tucked his tail and took off running. The Bible said the devil left him, and he's going to leave your house, and he's going to leave your family, and he's going to leave your life, and he's going to leave your mind, and he's going to leave your body. Come on and praise God, somebody. I'm through. I want to say this. You can fast for somebody. You can fast for others. It's one of the most powerful things you can do for someone else. Most of you have never heard of George McCluskey. But let me tell you who he is. He had 2 daughters and 1 son. One day the Lord spoke to him and said, fast for those children. I'm going to use them. And he began to fast every day, lunch, for those children. Two daughters and 1 son. Both of those daughters married preachers and went into the ministry. And then the son married the son felt called of God and went into pastoring. Then they had grandchildren. His children had grandchildren. The Lord spoke to him and said, start fasting for those grandchildren. He started doing the same thing. And listen to this. Every one of his granddaughters married preachers. And every one of his grandsons became preachers with the exception of one. He decided he wanted to be a psychologist and got his doctorate's degree. And then God called him to write books, and when it was all said and done, he became the number one Christian radio show on radio. His name is Dr. James Dobson. And Dr. Dobson will tell you that the reason he's in the ministry that he's in that is massive is because he had a grandfather who fasted for his parents and for the grandchildren. So you can fast for other people, even if they aren't open to what you know is right. If you will fast, God will deal with them. Give God praise if you believe it. Now I want to say this, and then we're going to stand and pray. You ain't got nowhere to go. Can't go eat lunch. Unless you're going to start after lunch. That's what people do sometimes. I get it. It's between you and God. And that's so important. Don't compete with people. When you're fasting, don't compete with people. If you're doing a total fast for the next 10 days, only drinking juice and water, don't act like you're more spiritual than somebody doing a Daniel fast. Because you just lost your reward with that attitude. You know, the Lord even spoke to me. He said, don't compete with yourself and pass fast. Last year, my wife and I together did the whole 21-day fast. For 21 days, we ate no food. We just drank liquids. And this year, I don't feel the grace to do that. I've got a busy schedule, and I'm going to do 10 days of total fast and other than water and juice, and then I'm converting over to the Daniel fast for the last 11 days. And I don't feel inferior to anybody who's doing the whole 21 days. God bless you. Great. Pray for me while you're on it. I appreciate it. Don't feel intimidated that way. That's not right. I told the early morning congregation, the first 3 days for me are tough because I'm a caffeine drinker. I love my coffee. And I need something warm all the time when I'm fasting. I'm just cold all the time. And so you know, the first few days, I've learned this, to wean myself off coffee. Oh, you cheater, you cheat. No. That's my fast. Now I can go around with a migraine headache. Or I can wean myself off. And so this morning when I went in, I'm down to about a half a cup of coffee. Now, you got to understand, I drink 3 or 4 cups of coffee a day. But now, through the 3 days, I'm down to a little half a cup of coffee. You know, and I walked into that room, the little work area over in the other building where they make the coffee, where I make my coffee early Sunday morning. I walked in, they had one of those little round things that has a camera in it. And when I walked in, something said to me, you better not do that. Somebody will see you on that camera. Don't get into all that stuff. Don't get into the legalism of the fast. You understand what I'm saying? If you mess up, then start right back over. You know what I'm saying? Don't beat yourself up. Don't do all that. Just relax, but go on and commit to what you're going to do and stick with it. That's the key. Because if you just kind of going to try and see, and I'm just going to see how this goes, and if I feel led, you will not feel led within 1 hour. The leading will go away. I see these big old football players over here. Man, y'all came the wrong Sunday. My God. These wonderful guys from the Falcons, they're sitting down there, and you ought to look at these jokers and try to preach on fasting now. That's a challenge, because they don't act like they like what I'm saying. They're just looking at me like they look at a quarterback. But God's going to honor it in your lives in whatever degree you can do it. He sees the sacrifice. What I want is a church that's hungry for God. What I want in my life is a revival. Lift your hands up and worship Him. Lift your hands up and praise Him. Lift your hands up and acknowledge your need of Him. break these habits. Set me free. Loose everything that's holding me back. Give me a continual flow of resources. Oh God, I cry out for these rewards. I want to be pure. I want to be clean. I want to know you. I'm tying a ribbon on my finger to remember you for the next 21 days with my fasting. We worship you, Jesus. We seek you, God, in your continual guidance on this fast. Hear your people as they cry out over the days and the hours. Hunger will grip their hearts before this day and their stomachs before this day is over. But God, receive it as a sweet-smelling sacrifice and let your Holy Spirit be attracted to their house, to their life, to their body. Let their health spring forth speedily. Restore the wastelands to fruitful orchards in Jesus' name.